Isn't that the beauty of redemption?
It changes everything. We're all broken people. Don't we all need Jesus? Yeah. Every moment of our lives, 24/365, our human is equal. Don't we all have our weakness? Yeah. Everybody makes mistakes. Yeah, everybody needs that grace. We all need Jesus. Oh, don't we all need Jesus? From the beggar to the rich man, from the prison to the preacher. Oh, all I know is we all need Jesus. All I know is we. Every man and every woman, oh, yeah, yeah. Every city, every nation.
Yeah. Good morning.
Good morning.
So glad that you decided to join us in worship this morning. We want to welcome you to here to South Shore. Whether you're joining us in person or you're joining us online, together we are the body of Christ, united in worship and praise of Him. So we invite you to rise and join us as we sing today, okay? I hear the sound.
I hear the sound of an army waking. I feel the ground under my feet shaking. Let justice roll like a river. Let justice roll like a river. Where your hands, where your feet, your people.
Mark 1:16-20 says this, and so I invite you to say this with me, please. As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. There are two things that really stand out to me in this passage that I think are appropriate for not just today, as Sarah's going to be talking about this later today, but also just for where we are as a church, that we are trying to reach out to this community. The first thing is that Jesus called not theologians, not scholars. He called everyday working people. He called you and me. And the second thing is that he didn't say, here's a plan, I want you to go over there and execute this plan. He said, follow me. He said, come with me where I am going. Christ is stepping out into this community each and every day, and he invites us to walk with him, to reach out to those around us, to be the hands and feet of Christ in the world around us.
Amen.
And we don't have to be qualified, because whatever our shortcomings are, God fills in those gaps. God empowers us and strengthens us and guides us, even a nobody like me. Had stage fright, and David brought a rock to a sword fight. You picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. Well, the moral of the story is everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me, saying, who do you think you are? I'll say, I'm just a nobody.
At South Shore United Methodist Church. My name is Sarah Miller, and it is my pleasure to serve as the pastor of this wonderful church. Friends, would you turn to your neighbor, greet them, pass the peace, tell them that you are happy to see them in worship today.
Thank you.
friends, we are so grateful that you have gathered here with us. A bulletin is available for today's service. You can find it by scanning the QR code now before you on your screen. It's also available on our church's website, southshoreumc.com/modern. Modern, it says it right there, modern. southshoreumc.com/modern, and a printout is available in our Welcome Center this morning. Friends, let us continue in worship now together. Would you join me in these words of prayer? Lord, we have nothing to fear in your presence. Your purposes always come to pass. Help us to live with such certainty in your power that we expect miracles in our daily lives. Amen.
I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. He won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out.
Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley.
Friends, would you come and join me for our children's moment this morning? Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. How is everybody today?
Good.
Doing all right? Doing all right? So we're continuing making our way through the lessons Jesus has for us contained in the word compassionate. And today we're looking at the second S. Now, if we read that word together, thank you, Miss Patsy, that second S for us today is going to stand for seeking to help. If you look at the letters that we have covered so far, these lessons from Jesus we've heard so far, the letters spell C-O-M-P-A-S-S, and that's the word compass. Friends, that was a revelation I had in the 8:30 service this morning. Compass! How great! God just, what is a compass? Church, what is a compass?
Points.
Yes, it's a directional device. So it's usually, well, back in the day, it was something you held in your hand, and it has arrows that point north, south, east, and west. And then we turned compasses into these boxes that you used to suction cup to the front windshield of your car, and they would say what? Recalculating. One time, Pastor Sarah and Mr. Andrew were driving, and it tried to tell us to forge this lake with our car. It was not equipped. We didn't have one of those cute little snorkels on the side of my Sonata. And now we have compasses, you know, kind of navigation systems on our phone. All of that to say, these lessons of Jesus are for us a compass. They're pointing us to where we should go. And Jesus is intentionally pointing us, as Mr. Drew said a few minutes ago, outward, externally, into our community. So this is the lesson Jesus has for us today about seeking to help. It's a story we have heard before. Luke 10 says, Jesus was asked, "Who is my neighbor?" To answer the question, Jesus told this story. There was a Jewish man walking a dangerous road, and he was beaten badly by thieves and left on the side of the road. As the man lay there, a priest walked by, and when he saw the hurt man, he crossed over to the other side of the road to avoid the man that was hurt. A Levite, a person who worked in a synagogue, was also walking down this dangerous road, and when he saw the hurt man, he crossed over to the other side of the road too. There was also a Samaritan, an enemy of the Jewish people, walking this dangerous road. But when the Samaritan saw the hurt man, he felt compassion. He knew it was right to help the hurt man, even though their cultures were enemies. The Samaritan bandaged the man's wounds, placed the man on his donkey, and took him to an inn to care for him. You know, Jesus, he likes to teach using stories, and often in the stories that Jesus used to teach, he made the hero someone totally unexpected. Like, it was unexpected that a Samaritan would be the person to step out and help someone who was completely different. Jews and Samaritans were as different as chocolate candy and balsamic glazed Brussels sprouts. Exactly. They were.
You had me and then you lost me.
They were that different. And yet, Jesus said, like this Samaritan came to help this Jewish person, someone who was like Jesus or like one of his friends who was likely there hearing that story that day. That's the kind of helper that we're meant to be. Jesus lifted up Samaritans, Romans, women, children, people who were poor, people who were sick, saying that these members are important people in our community and they have something to teach us and we need to be like them. We need to show the care and concern that they do for others. And so as we grow in compassion, as we look out into our neighborhoods to see what connections we can make so that we can be God's beautiful family together, one of the best ways we can do that is identifying how we can help and by listening. Because if we listen, people will tell us exactly the kind of help that they're looking for. Okay? Let's pray together, my friends. Ready? Pray.
Dear God,
give me strength.
Give me strength
for the work,
for the work
you have for me.
You have for me.
As I serve,
may I do so
with joy in my heart.
With joy in my heart.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, friends, let's sing together This Little Light of Mine.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Thanks, friends. If you are headed to Children's Church with Mr. Scotty and Scatter, which door are they headed out, Mr. Scotty?
This door over here.
That door, right over there.
Like a laser beam.
There were gummy worms, people. Breaking news. Also, it's really warm in here. Could you turn the air down, please? Thank you. Having a hot flash. In the 2009 Clint Eastwood film Invictus, main character Francois Pienaar, who's played by Matt Damon, receives an invitation to tea with the president of South Africa. Morgan Freeman plays Nelson Mandela in that film. And once tea is served, the scene recalls an interaction between Mandela and Pienaar, who is the captain of the South African Springbok rugby team. Mandela is asking Pienaar about his philosophy of leadership, specifically exploring the relationship between leadership and inspiring his fellow players to do their best. As Mandela, Freeman asks this question: how to get your team to be better than they think they can be? That is very difficult, I find. Inspiration, perhaps. How do we inspire ourselves to greatness when nothing less will do? How do we inspire everyone around us? Sometimes I think it's by using the work of others. Nelson Mandela was imprisoned for 27 years for his anti-apartheid activism. While jailed, he often turned to a Victorian poem by William Ernest Henley to inspire him. Henley's poem was the inspiration for the name of Eastwood's film. It reads: out of the night that covers me, black as the pit from pole to pole, I thank whatever gods may be for my unconquerable soul. In the fell clutch of circumstance, I have not winced nor cried aloud. Under the bludgeonings of chance, my head is blood, but unbowed. Beyond this place of wrath and tears looms but the horror of the shade, and yet the menace of the years finds and shall find me unafraid. It matters not how straight the gate, how charged with punishments the scroll. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul. At the conclusion of their tea, Mandela says to Pienaar, the country of South Africa needs inspiration. In order to build our nation, we must all exceed our own expectations. When Jesus called and calls disciples, his is an invitation to exceed our own expectations, to exceed present circumstances, both those of our own choosing and those that have been chosen for us. Consider this sculpture. It depicts Mandela's face when perfectly aligned. This sculpture is made out of iron bars, just like the ones that imprisoned him. He was inspired. Mandela was inspired to exceed his present circumstances that not only scarred his body and his heart, but also those of his fellow country persons. Mandela helped lead South Africans to exceed their own expectations, the expectations of their history, and to invest heart, body, mind, and soul and strength into the shaping of a life-giving legacy. Our Jesus came to save. He also came to inspire. To be inspired, one must first be exposed. And so Jesus said, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Deciding to follow Jesus, that moment of becoming a disciple, was not and is not an invitation to easy street. Ahead of disciples, both past and present, there's much to learn, much stumbling, much misunderstanding, and a whole lot of opportunity for making mistakes or backsliding. Becoming a faithful Christian disciple, friends, it takes both a moment and a lifetime. In Matthew's gospel, we see how this one-time decision needs to be reaffirmed and even corrected over the course of a lifetime. Consider Simon Peter, one of the first disciples called by Jesus. At Caesarea Philippi, before this incredible pantheon of Roman and pagan gods, Peter makes his profession of faith. He says who Jesus is. And yet he does not affirm his faith in Jesus as the suffering Messiah. Doing that will take a lifetime. On the moment, on the Mount of Transfiguration, Peter knows how good it is to be with Jesus, so much so he wants to erect tents there, that Jesus and Elijah and Moses, they'll all stay there with Peter and the other disciples. Peter forgets in that moment that the real task is to follow Jesus for a lifetime. In that courtyard, warming himself before the fire, Peter threatens to give up a lifetime of fidelity to Jesus, who's already been arrested because of one moment of fear. And then at the very end, when Jesus is on the cross, Peter, Andrew, James, and John, the original four disciples, they are nowhere to be found. Even then, God doesn't count that one moment as the final word. Because from that place, we know that Jesus goes to the tomb, and then Jesus rises again to go before all disciples throughout all time. the moment of conversion. We make a big deal in the Christian faith about the moment of conversion. There's lots going on in that moment of accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior, as following Jesus as a disciple, of living a life becoming of Jesus' good news. That moment is an important one. Wrapped up in it is our awareness of God and our repentance of sin, our acceptance of grace, our commitment to Christ. But that one moment of conversion, that singular moment of conversion, is not the only moment that there is. It is just one moment to be followed by a lifetime of moments inspired by Jesus calling us that also inspire hope, inspire joy, inspire generosity, inspires change. That one moment of Jesus calling us to inspire for us continual moments of new life in Christ across our lifetimes. Jesus called the disciples away from their nets. And then he uses the very same as an inspiration for what he calls all disciples to do. We read from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 13. Beginning in verse 47, Jesus says, "Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." The parable of the dragnet begins like its six Kingdom of God parable siblings. The kingdom of heaven is, Jesus says, not will be, not might, not perhaps. The kingdom of heaven is. This mighty two-letter verb affirms Jesus' insistence in the presentness of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is a revelation. It is revealed to us. We are exposed to the kingdom so that we might be inspired by it and inspired to contribute to it. Jesus teaches about the kingdom using the ordinary, and his doing so makes those ordinary things extraordinary, which affirms for us that the extraordinary kingdom is indeed to be found in the ordinary things. And most especially, it's to be found in you and in me. Barbara Brown Taylor writes that if we want to speak about heavenly things, Jesus seems to say we first begin to speak about earthly things. And if we want to describe that which is beyond all words, may we begin with words that we know. Words like man and woman, field, seed, bird, air, yeast, and bread. With words like pearl and net, sea, fish, and joy. These are the places for us to dig for heaven. These are the places to look for the will and the rule and the presence of God. If we cannot find them here, then we will never find them anywhere else. For earth is where the seeds of heaven are sown, and their treasure is the only one worth having. By looking at our lives, at our surroundings, through kingdom eyes, we see where the kingdom lies. And friends, if we aren't inspired, then we have sight, but no vision. The kingdom is in each of us. It's in the places that we are, and the professions that we have, and the pastimes that we enjoy, in the food that we eat. It's in the relationships that we nurture. We encounter the kingdom in simple, profound moments of revelation and inspiration, in single moments in time that by their very nature will understand over our lifetimes. Or as my mother would sing over me, we'll understand it better by and by. In that same spirit of the sower, who freely and inclusively scattered her seed, the fisherman in this parable indiscriminately casts his net. Fish of all kinds are drawn into the net. The fisherman receives and brings them to shore where they will be sorted. In the explanation of the parable, Jesus teaches us that the fisherman is not the one that separates the fish. That work is left for the angels. Jesus was the original fisher of people. After calling and welcoming the disciples into the kingdom, he commissioned them to continue his work in kind. Those who were caught became the ones who will catch, and God's net of grace is incredibly wide. It reaches great depths and draws an incredible and perhaps unlikely abundance to shore. This parable of the dragnet concludes Jesus' teaching in Matthew 13, echoing where the kingdom of heaven parables began, with this lesson, with this affirmation and assurance that the kingdom of God is generous and inclusive. It is a place where every soul is Jesus' guest, where every person is of sacred worth, created and beloved in the image of God. We all have reasons in our lives for why God's grace could have or should have passed us by. But we have not fallen out of the net. And we have not been cast from shore. Therefore, it's not our role, it's not our place to deny someone access to the kingdom or to refuse them an experience of God's grace, or they're living out God's grace through their lives. We misunderstand our role and our purpose in the kingdom of God when we act in those behaviors. God tells us it is our place to welcome one and all, the old and the young, the good and the bad, the polished and the tarnished, and in the interim, before the angelic sorting, however long that interim may be. It's our role to continue that ongoing care of one another. If someone is missing from our fellowship or has experienced harm while in our fellowship, Jesus calls us to two acts. The first is to identify, to name the person, to lift them up. The second is to rectify, to reconcile, to seek forgiveness for the harm done. It's one thing for someone to self-select in leaving a fellowship. It's another thing entirely for someone to leave or feel that they need to leave because we did not offer a congruous and consistent community of care. Our Jesus catches us with grace and then sends us to fish in his name. Jesus calls us as disciples and calls us to his dragnets. We know not the time that the sorting will begin. God will take care of that. So in this meantime, in between time, let us take care to care for one another and abide with one another in peace as we continue fishing. Jesus asks in Matthew 13, verse 51, after teaching all of these parables, have you understood all this? May we evidence our exposure to Christ, our inspiration from Christ, through our applied comprehension of his baptism, ministry, and resurrection. When we do this, then we too will hear our voices alongside the first disciples saying the word, yes. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, it has been a week, right? It has been a week. There have been some really high highs, some good things that have happened this week. And there have been some really low lows that have happened this week. I have seen people overjoyed by decisions that have been made. I have seen people crushed and aching by decisions that have been made. I have seen a family in shreds as they stood around a graveside. It has been a week. And I want to name that, and I want us to share a prayer together about that. As you can imagine, we read lots of children's books in our home, and one of Joshua's favorite books is The Very Hungry Caterpillar. Also, there was someone in the first service who did not know of the caterpillar and his hunger, and so we rehearsed that for him this morning. We wanted him to be included in the caterpillar's plight. Y'all know the story. Caterpillar emerges from the egg, and he says, "What? I'm hungry." And he seeks after some food, and he eats through an apple and some pears and some plums and some strawberries and some oranges. And then on Saturday, this sounds like a day of rest, right? On Saturday, he eats through a piece of chocolate cake, a lollipop, a piece of pie, a cupcake, a sausage, a slice of Swiss cheese, a slice of salami, a hot dog, and some watermelon. Yum. And then he has a tummy ache. The caterpillar then thinks, maybe a leaf. I'll eat a leaf. He chomps through a leaf. And then he's no longer a little caterpillar, but a big caterpillar. And he forms a cocoon. That cocoon, that place where transformation happens. Now, inside the cocoon, a caterpillar doesn't just, you know, grab a roll of duct tape and slap some wings on his back. That is not how that process happens. Did you know that the caterpillar basically dissolves into goo within that cocoon? And then from that goo, God works how God works, and then emerges this beautiful butterfly. I say all of that because of the high highs and the low lows that have happened this week in our country, in our personal lives, in our families, some of us may be feeling like goo this morning. What we know about goo is it's not very attractive. It's not pretty. Sometimes it smells. We'd really just like somebody, you know, to clean it up, get it away from us. You're feeling like goo. God sees you. God is holding you in God's hands. God's transformation is already at work. We can put our trust in that. Part of our transformation includes putting feet to our faith. I know that one of the best ways for me to stop feeling gooey is to help a neighbor, is to be a friend, is to stifle my yawn and read one more time about that very hungry caterpillar, because it's going to put a smile on my child's face and assure him that I love him and I see him and we're going to do this thing of life together. Regardless of the high highs and the low lows, we are community. We're family. So friends, whatever you're feeling today, whatever degree of goo you might be, let's hold that before God in prayer. Let us pray. Oh God, how grateful we are for the place that you give us in your creation. The purpose that you give us, that we are to live and love with all that you have made. And oh God, we confess that sometimes we fail, that sometimes we harm one another, that sometimes we abuse what you give us by our thoughts, actions, and the meditations of our hearts. We show how enmeshed we are with sin. Far from walking in your spirit, we stumble on paths that lead to death. And so God, we call down your fire from heaven, that you would refine us, have mercy on us, that you would satisfy the longings of our souls by taking us up into your spirit, that you would teach us how to best love our neighbor. God, rekindle in us your desire to follow our Savior, Christ Jesus, whose passion for obeying you leads us to our inheritance, leads us to your promised kingdom. To you and the Son and the Spirit, one God, be all worship and praise, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to his Father in heaven, and then broke the bread. He shared it with his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to his Father in heaven, and then shared it with his disciples. He said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Almighty God, we ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And with confidence as your children, we pray as our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In the United Methodist tradition, we practice what is known as open communion table, which means you need not be a member of this church or any church to come and receive the gift of the sacrament this morning. Communion will be served four ways this morning. And friends that are worshiping with us at home, I hope that your table is set to join us. The first opportunity for communion is via pre-packaged celebration cup, which you can receive at the station that will be to the right in the chancel area. We have gluten-free communion provided this morning. If that is the best choice for you, please come to the altar table. And then we have cup and bread service. Friends participating, receiving in cup and bread service, please come with your hands cupped, and I will place a piece of bread into your cupped hands. You can then move either to the chalice to dip your piece of bread into the cup or to receive an individual communion cup. There are baskets located on the aisles on the front pew for you to discard your celebration cup or individual cup of juice on the way back to your seats. We will serve first our communion servers and our worship team, and then we will open up service to the body. Will worship team and communion servers please come forward? Is the body of Christ. And it's given for you. This is the blood of Christ, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Friends, the table is set. Please come as you're led.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. My soul prays, for he is thine help and salvation. Praise to the Lord, who o'er all things so wonderfully reigneth, shelters thee under his wings, yea, so gladly sustaineth. Hast thou not seen how they dine? In one doth prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely his goodness and mercy here daily attend thee. And ponder anew what the Almighty can do. If with his love we befriend thee.
Would you rise and join us for the last verse?
Praise to the Lord, let all that is in me adore him. All that hath life and breath, come now with praises before him. Let the amen sound from his people again. Gladly for
amen.
Let the amen sound from his people again. Gladly for I we adore him. Hallelujah.
Prepare now to receive our morning tithes and offerings. Please take note of the location of the offering plates in the worship center. And as we continue in song together, move to the plate nearest you to share your gift with God. You can also navigate to southshoreumc.com/onlinegiving and share your gift with God through that platform. Additional offerings to name and give thanks for this week. One is we've had an incredible response to our, it's beginning to look a little bit like Christmas, to seed our Angel Tree mission this holiday season. We will share with the congregation what that total that's been donated is next week. And that number is going to make this guy, Mark Krause, real happy because he is co-chair of our Angel Tree mission with Bobby Harris. So we're excited to tell you all about that next week. If you still want to get in a gift card to donate, there's time. Secondly, our second Let's Get Real with Reels, Viewing Movies with a Purpose, this Wednesday, showings at 1:30 and 6 o'clock. We're watching Green Book. Join us for that movie viewing and conversation. Let, yes, Christina.
Just to bring it up to the congregation.
Yes.
I was at the food bank at the ReStore this week.
Yes.
And said the shelves are really, really, really bare. So I know, you know, one family can't make a difference, but multiple can.
Yes. Thank you. I will repeat that for the body. Pastor Dave serves weekly up at our mission partner, ReStore. Their shelves are bare. We know that with the current economy, costs are going up. Demands on people's resources are becoming tighter and tighter. And so next Sunday is our first Sunday. Wouldn't it be great if we could restock those shelves for ReStore? Will you help us with that? Will you bring your donations next Sunday? And if y'all bring them today, I will get them there before next Sunday. So there's that challenge too. Thank you for lifting that up, Christina. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this day, for the abundance of gifts that you will pour out upon us, your children. We ask that you would add your special blessing to these, our morning tithes and offerings. That you would bless those who wanted to give but did not have, and bless those who gave so that others may have, to the furtherance of your kingdom on earth. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Who breaks the power?
Lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.